Karen with the Can, come to you guys with a new video. So today's video, as you can tell by the title, is another legal tea series video. Yay! Thank you all so much for all the love and support with this series. I'm really excited. I'm really passionate about it because I am a law student. For those of you that don't know, I'm in my second year, second semester. Okay, like I have two more semesters, not including this semester, so three semesters total. But anyway, I'm excited. So yay! Anyway, so this video is going to be about how to choose what law school to go to. So right now, during the cycle, depending on where you're at, you're either about to take the LSAT in February, or you're already submitting your applications, or you're going to submit your applications because you just got your December score, or whatever the case may be. So I would just say congratulations and good luck on your law school journey. If you have any questions or concerns, do not hesitate to email me or to contact me through the comment sections or DM me on Instagram or something like that. I'm always here to help. I've had a few people reach out to me, so I hope I was helpful. They said I was, so yay. But without further ado, let's go ahead and get into this legal tea. So how to choose which law school to go to. There are several things that you should consider. One of the number one things is location. So for me, I knew I wanted to be near my mom. At the time, she was in Georgia, and I went to undergrad in Georgia at Kennesaw State University. If you have not seen my Q&A or any of my other legal tea series videos, I will leave those in the description box below. But yeah, so I knew I wanted to stay in the South. I wouldn't have mind going to DC. That was an option at the time. So overall, I'll just tell you which states that I applied to, not the specific schools, but which states. I applied to a couple schools in Georgia. I applied to schools in DC, a school in DC. I applied to a couple schools in Texas, Alabama. I did apply to school in Michigan. That's where I'm originally from. I'm from Flint. I feel like I applied to a school in Florida. You know, I ended up not applying to a school. No, I did apply to a school in Florida, I think. I had a free fee waiver, but anyways. And then I ended up in Alabama. So for me, I chose Cumberland because when I went to the school, I just kind of knew. Like, I had went to a lot of, my glasses is dirty, y'all. Whole glass is dirty. All right, we back. So for me, I think touring schools can kind of give you a better idea of which school to go to, which kind of leads me into the environment you want to be in. For me, I knew I didn't want to be, I don't know, in like a cutthroat, we're ripping pages out your books type environment. And there are some schools that are like that. And there are some schools that are like that that aren't in like the top 20%, top 20 schools, for instance. And also something about location, know that what school you go to in that state, if it's not a top 20 school, for instance, or top 15, it kind of just depends on how you look at the ratings and stuff like that, then that school's, I guess, weight of that name might not go as far. So, for instance, if you go to, like, Harvard, of course you could take that name and practice anywhere in the United States as long as you pass the bar in those states and things of that nature. But as far as, like, the name holding weight when you're talking to other attorneys and when you're networking and things like that, you want to make sure where you go you would be willing to practice there and be willing to practice in an area close to there. Just know your school's reputation, I guess is what I'm trying to say. So I knew when I chose Cumberland, I heard no matter where I practiced, whether it was Georgia or Michigan or DC or whatever, like the name held pretty good weight. It's not top 20, it's not a top, what, four tier or all the tiers, I don't know how tiers work. I wouldn't worry about all that. But I wanted a school name that had a good reputation and held some weight, if that makes some sense.
So I wanted to add a quick little tip right here that I forgot. Also, make sure you know the school's specialization. Like, for instance, Cumberland, they specialize in their trial advocacy program. They have a really good trial advocacy program. I knew I wanted to do trial work. I love being in the courtroom, even though I'm not opposed to doing transactional work. It just kind of depends. But I want to throw that out there, so make sure you do the research on the school and see, like, what area they specialize in. For instance, if you want to do immigration law, I heard that University of Alabama is good for that. So, yeah.
So yeah, that's why I chose Cumberland. I had never been to Alabama, never knew anything about Alabama. It was just near Georgia. Actually, a quick little story time. So a representative from Cumberland went to my undergrad university, and they were just talking about it, showing pictures. I was like, oh, it's really pretty. Sounds good. Nice. My GPA and my LSAT was, you know, pretty much up there. So I was like, all right, let me go ahead and apply. They were actually my first yes I got, and I cried when I got it because I also got a partial scholarship. And it was my first yes because I had applied not late in the game, but not early. It was pretty late in the game when I applied, when I sent out my applications. I think I sent them out at the end of January, beginning of February. I want to say I sent them out before February LSAT. I want to say that. And I didn't hear back from them. I think I want to say, I should have pulled up my email and got it right, but I want to say it was like in April. It was like in March or April because I got my acceptance like 2 weeks before the Admitted Students Weekend, and I was like, oh crap, I'm gonna go to that, because I hadn't visited the school, so I was like, let me go see what it looks like, you know what I'm saying? Then all my acceptance and things like that started rolling in, and some denies, you know, that's okay, it's part of the game, you win some, you lose some. But I wanted to make sure that I actually liked the school and the environment, just in case I ended up living there. So touring schools are definitely important, and yeah, but that was just like my little story. So overall, the representative came, I was like, cool, I'll apply, whatever. I got in, I was like, let me go to Mid-Students Weekend, and I fell in love with the campus, fell in love with the school, people, all that. So that's my quick little story. Aside from location, I took some notes. Let me look at my little notes. You know this is a state that you don't want to be in and don't want to practice in. I say don't go to law school there if you just are 100% sure. However, you never know, you might fall in love with the place, you might fall in love with people, you never know. Kind of like me, like, I really was planning on not staying in Alabama. I was like, I'm going back to Georgia, going to Atlanta. I was not staying here. But, I mean, you know, I've grown to like Alabama for real. And, you know, you never know. Can't leave Bay, you know. But if I do get a job opportunity elsewhere, of course I'll take advantage of that. I mean, I'm young. I ain't got no kids. I'm not married. So, and side note, a lot of people are thinking this is a marriage ring. This is my right hand. Okay, right hand. Left hand is still empty. Okay. Another way to help you choose with law school is to reach out to the schools, reach out to alumni, and reach out to current law students to get a feel for them and get a feel for better feel for the school. I know when I came and Mid-Students Students Weekend, I was able to talk to their student ambassadors, which, I mean, I know they're like directly with the school, so it's kind of like I could have talked to some other students. But talking to students at the school really give you a better idea of like what it's going to be like to be a law student, because, I mean, that's what you're going to be doing. You're going to be doing what they're doing. So talking to people that have the direct experience that are going through right now, you'll get a real deal, like, no strings attached type answer to a lot of your questions, and just straight up blunt answers, which I really appreciated. So thank you to the student ambassadors that I met when I was a prospect student. So definitely talk to students, talk to alumni, talk to professors, and just talk to people that know about the school. Get as much information as you can about the school and do your own research. Go to the school's website, go to lsac.org. They have information about the schools. And also, I know this is like obvious, but I'm still gonna say it. Look at their acceptance rates as far as their GPA and their LSAT scores. Look at their medium, look at their low, look at their high. You can kind of separate your schools into categories. Rich schools would be schools that you're really not in their GPA or their LSAT like range. So, but you still apply. I always say, especially if you have a fee waiver, if it's a school you really, really want to go to and you just don't have the scores and don't have the GPA, or one or the other, vice versa, still apply. And still apply, give it your best, reach out to people if you know, reach out to alumni, get some bomb letters recommendation, and just go for it. You never know. And then there's also schools that you just, another level of schools, it's just that you know you, like, you are within there. So that's the reach schools, and then you have the school, your target schools, where you're right on target. You all have the GPA requirement that they usually accept, you have the LSAT score that they usually accept, so that's good. And then you can kind of have some middle schools that you apply to that are like, just, you're kind of in between, or you have one or the other, or something like that. So definitely consider that. And last but not least, money. I get a lot of questions on how to juggle money, because in law school you really can't work. I mean, people work, but your first year you can't work. I mean, you could, I guess, maybe kind of. No, you really can't. No, you can't. But I get a lot of questions about that, money management, and I'll do a whole other video about that. From my perspective, I can only give my perspective. Okay, so that's that, but I'll talk about that in another video. Thumbs this up if you would like to see that video. And while I'm already talking about that kind of thing, make sure you comment below if you have any other video recommendations. Please, I really appreciate them, just to kind of give me a better idea of what you guys are looking for. Because when it comes to law school, there's just so many different areas and things that I could talk about. Sometimes I get like scatterbrained, so I'm like, what do they want to see? What should I talk about? I will say I will have a video about the application process. I had recorded a video, I hated it, I just didn't like it, so I'm going to re-record it. So that's going to be coming. So stay tuned for that. So when it comes to bills and money and tuition, know the school's tuition. That's going to help you choose a school. Know your budget. I mean, it's going to be expensive. I mean, that's just me, unless you're on a full ride. So if you do get scholarship, take that into consideration, because it's free money. You're getting the JD. You know what I mean? You're getting the Juris Doctorate. So I don't want to say just go for the school that gave you like the full ride or the better scholarship. But if you're all right with that location, or you like the school, I would definitely consider that, because it's so expensive and loans is real. Like, I have undergraduate loans on top of my law school loans, so your girl is swimming in debt. Thankfully, I'm a partial scholarship, but I still pretty much take out the maximum loans because I'm not working. My family ain't rich, so that's what it is. It is what it is. But I don't know. It just really consider your limits on that. So, for instance, like, if my mom lived in Alabama, like, I probably would live at home if it was close enough, just because, like, I could save some coins. Or if you're okay with having roommates, have roommates and save some coins. A lot of law schools don't have on-campus living, so some, I don't think I ran into any, and I toured a lot of schools. So keep that in mind as well. They do have, like, where they can match you up at most law schools with another law student or with a medical student, because it's, like, kind of similar with study habits. So that's a good idea, too. But just keep in mind everything. Or if you have a job and they'll be willing to work with your crazy hours of schedule and things like that, and you might want to stay in that state, just consider everything when it comes to, like, your regular bills. Because, I mean, my car's still here. I still got a car payment, like, regardless of what school I went to. Still got a phone bill. I have my own apartment, so electricity, water, you know, my apartment rent, things like that. Just things you don't realize when you're working. Like, I've been working since I was like 14. So when you stop working, you're like, oh wow, I don't have a steady income. You do get loans, and they're more than your undergraduate loan, so you do get a refund, but it's not that much, because they give you like a little, at my school for instance, they gave you like a little payment plan, so they kind of tell you how much to spend in different areas and how it works out. But life happens, you get sick, you know, your car breaks down, things like that. So you want to kind of have a savings for a rainy day, or just have like a little side hustle. Like for me, YouTube, like, if only y'all knew, I don't want to give all my business, but it really has helped me out. Like, by the grace of God, YouTube is great. So I'm thankful for that. So if you have some kind of side hustle, definitely do that. If you work weekends, do that, but your grades come first. Law school is an investment, so no matter where you go, I mean, keep that in mind. But there are some schools that are cheaper than others, especially, like, for instance, in Georgia, there's, like, University of Georgia is cheaper. If you're a Georgia resident, if you know for sure you want to practice in Georgia and the school's good, why not do it? Just like Georgia State, things like that. That's just examples, but. So, yeah, guys, that's pretty much it. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I feel like it was pretty quick. It's pretty good tips, you guys. So if you have any other questions, comments, or concerns, just leave them down in the comment section or reach out to me. I hope I hit some good points for you guys. Overall, you just go on campus. For me, I went on the campus and I just knew it was a school for me. It sounds cheesy, but that's just how it worked. And then, you know, at first it was kind of like, I'm in a state by myself. I have no family, no friends. Now I have friends, but it can be an adjustment. It can be hard, but it's worth it. Like, I wouldn't change it for anything. I met some amazing people. Like, I've had a great experience. I'm making some really good networks. And that's another thing. You kind of build your network, your legal network, while you're in school. So if you're in that state, you're going to build it in that state. So, but it ended up working out for me. I like Alabama. I wouldn't trade it. I love Cumberland. So, yeah. Yeah, don't forget to share this video with your family and friends. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. And I'll see you guys in my next video. Love you guys. Later.